Hi, good morning, everybody. As Charles said, I am Todd Forrest, and I am Arthur Ross, Vice President for Horticulture and Living Collections here at the Garden, and it's my honor to kick off this this symposium, Preserving the Mighty Oak. Thought a lot about this, and before I kind of launch into my carefully scripted deal, I just wanted to say thank you all for venturing out in less than ideal weather circumstances. I guess better today than next Tuesday. And to me, as I look around this room and I see lots of garden staff members, lots of parks department staff members, lots of interested amateurs, I am warmed to be reminded that people care deeply about the trees in their lives. And if you're going to care deeply about a tree in your life and you live anywhere in the Northern Hemisphere, oaks are a tree to care deeply about. Oaks are inspiring parts of this garden. Oaks are inspiring important parts of our local ecosystems. And we're going to learn a lot about their role and their importance and the threats that face them and ways we can begin to address those threats. Oaks are the most abundant type of tree here at the New York Botanical Garden. Our landscape features hundreds of venerable white, black, scarlet pin, and swamp white oaks, many far older than the garden itself. In fact, the oldest oaks here are on the order of 300 years old, maybe a little bit more. The roughly 350 species of oak native across the Northern Hemisphere play a seminal ecological role in a range of ecosystems from savanna to moist forests. They sustain countless species of birds, mammals, and insects. They fix carbon, filter storm water, produce oxygen, and remove pollutants on an epic scale. Oaks are also economically important wherever they grow. Oak wood is used to make everything from fine furniture to fine bourbon. The corks that seal the best Bordeaux are made from oak bark. Acorns fatten the pigs that become prosciutto to Parma. And oak roots sustain truffles. You can all see where my head was at as I was putting this together, and I'm getting hungry again just thinking about oaks. Unfortunately, oaks are at risk from a combination of factors, including habitat destruction, climate change, invasive species, among many others. It is becoming very clear that if we are not proactive, we risk losing oaks in our gardens and forests, just as we have lost so many iconic forest trees over the past century. The goal of today's symposium is to both celebrate the mighty oak and better understand the steps we can take to preserve oaks in the landscape. We are fortunate to have five knowledgeable and engaging speakers. We have a bonus speaker, which is great, with us today. We'll hear from our first two speakers, take a short break, and then resume. After the final speaker, the audience will have an opportunity to ask some questions, so please hold your questions to the very end. And also, this is probably a good time for me to remind you all to turn off your cell phones. Our first two speakers will provide some context about oaks and commerce, gardens, and nature. Bill Logan, author, consulting arborist, and founder and president of Urban Arborists and card-carrying quercifile, will describe the cultural and horticultural significance of oaks. He will be followed by Bill Schuster, executive director of the Black Rock Forest Consortium in Cornwall, New York, who will provide insight into the ecological importance of oaks in our region and ongoing research at the Black Rock Forest. We'll take a quick break, about 10 minutes, and we'll be very, very, very strict about that. It's a long program, after Dr. Schuster's talk, and then resume to the second half of the program. So without further ado, please welcome Bill Logan.
Thank you all. I'm so glad to be here, and I'm so glad to be here with these speakers who I'm very much looking forward to hearing as soon as I'm done. I'm the warm-up guy and the color man. So I'm going to tell you about oaks and our relationship to them, basically since the Neolithic and leading up to today. This is my favorite picture of oak trees. It is the Cowthorpe oak, which is no longer there in England. And it is a vast exaggeration of the size of the Cowthorpe oak. But you can see that the interesting thing is they put an entire village under the Cowthorpe oak. They're doing everything from dancing to making business deals to giving political speeches to riding about on their horses. The entire life of this village is taking place underneath this oak. And what I want to argue is that's not simply a romantic exaggeration. It's a fair representation of the importance of the relationship between people and oak trees, not to mention between numerous other creatures and oak trees around the temperate world, at least since the Ice Age ended. When I started my book about oak trees, I wanted to find out where oaks were around the world. I knew that in California, where I grew up, we had a whole ton of them. And then when I moved here to New York, we had a whole ton of them, and that the native species had no species in common between the two different places. I said, that's kind of odd. I wonder where oaks are. So I asked somebody to find me a map of oak distribution, and I got this map. And I thought, my God, they haven't found me a map of oak distribution. They found me a map of the world civilizations, in the course of world civilizations. Doesn't it kind of match world civilizations? So I said, no, that can't be it. So I was about to say, please go back and find me the right one. And I put on my glasses and looked at the caption, which was world oak distribution. So this is the distribution of oaks around the world. It's an extraordinary number of them. I believe Todd just said 350. I think a good way to start a fight in an oak taxonomist convention is to put list any number between 250 and 400 and say that's the number of oak species there are. And then you'll start a big fight. Because oaks are so able to vary that there's a lot of controversy as to just how many species there are, but probably at least 250, as many as 400, spread all around the world. We have a fair number of them, about 90 in North America. They have a ton of them in Mexico, about 160. It's the greatest density of different oak species in the world. Another 100 in China and Southeast Asia. So in where they've been most important culturally in Europe, they're comparatively impoverished in number of species. But they are scattered throughout all of this area. And there, you know, they attract huge numbers of creatures that live and depend upon them. Red oak around here has at least 1,000 insects and arthropods that depend upon it. In England, 200 moth species alone depend upon the English oak. The jays who have spread the oaks after the Ice Age were one of the main spreaders of them, have evolved a kind of big throat in which they can fit tons of acorns. A good jay can fit 5 red oak acorns, which is, I mean, I couldn't fit 5 red oak acorns in my mouth, in their mouth and spread them about. So there's this incredible relationship that's going on between not only us and oak trees, but all other creatures and oak trees. An acre of oak wood will make about, take about 2 tons of carbon out of the atmosphere in a year, and make about 9 cords of wood. So out of that 1 year's growth in that acre, you will get at the very least 9 cords. So that's 4 by 4 foot by 4 foot by 72 feet long of new wood created out of thin air, basically, at that time. And in a good mast year, we'll have a red oak around here, we'll make about 90,000 acorns. So oak trees are common, persistent, flexible. They've been very, very important to the way that human beings have turned from hominids into human beings, because people learned very early to make things with oaks. And the more they made, the more they could reflect on what they'd made, and the more they reflected, the more they could make. So we see a kind of progressive opening of the mind, widening of the heart, instructing of the hand through the relationship between people and oak trees. First thing that we certainly did was eat them. I had to know this. I grew up in California. Any of you who did, probably you still can't get out of eighth grade without passing the California history exam. And in that they ask you, what did the California native peoples eat? Answer, acorns. And they still do. I talked to a Pomo woman in Middle California, who said best memory of her childhood was the feasts they would have. And they would make this feast by her mother would make a bed of coals. And then on that bed of coals, she would set a layer of leaves and then a layer of acorn mush. And on top of that layer of acorn mush, she would set some venison and then another layer of leaves and then some acorn mush and then a layer of salmon and et cetera, until the whole pile was 4 or 5 feet high. Then they would cover it with dirt, leave it overnight, and then they would all stand around it in the morning and see who was going to get to be the first to break it open and start eating it. So that's a very festival dish of oak, but it was also a very good travel food. It's a food which, if you've ever eaten it, and it's not that hard to prepare it to do, you'll find that it doesn't have much flavor, but after you've eaten it, you don't feel hungry for a good long time. John Muir thought it was the very best and most strength-giving and compact food he could carry when he was walking around the mountains of California. So very important. You can see when I was a little kid, we would often come on rocks like this in the middle of the landscape that had these big holes in them and said to our parents, what the heck is that? Said, that's where the Indians ground their acorns. And you can still see them there. So this was the mortar with which you ground was one of a woman's most important possessions. And typically women would be buried with their mortar when they died. This is a leaching pit, a kind of a very formal one. Most acorns, it's very important that you leach the tannins out of them before eating them. If you try, like for example, a red oak acorn from around here without leaching it, you're gonna not be enjoying it very much. It will make you pucker up and you probably can't swallow it. So leaching is a very important step in the preparation of acorn for food. So certainly the Californians were eating acorn, but it's curious to look, and you start looking around the world, you can still go to a Korean market and buy acorn flour packaged ready for you. The acorns, they make extraordinary things still. There's a Korean restaurant on 32nd Street where they make acorn noodle salad, which is absolutely delicious. So some people still eat it, but quite a lot of people ate it in the old days. Just as, you know, we have this imagination of Arcadian people around the Mediterranean living on sheep, basically. Those very people who were living at that time had legends of a more distant past in which people lived on acorns in the Mediterranean area. This is Quercus ilex, the common circum-Mediterranean evergreen acorn, which, by the way, you can eat without leaching. I know this because I asked an old lady there's an agroforestry system called the Dehesa made of these. I asked an old lady if I could eat them without leaching, and she said, sure you can. And I said, well, I better go find some. She said, don't worry, I got some here. And she reached into her pocket and gave me one and showed me how to open it. We ate it, and it was tart, but quite edible. Still, I think in many cases these were leached, but they were an important foodstuff in that region of the world, so it wasn't only the Californians eating it. If you look at the work of Hesiod back in the 8th century BC, he says, honest people don't suffer from famine because the gods give them acorn-bearing oaks, sheep, and honey. So the idea was that people were living at that time on oaks. Ovid said the same thing, Pausanias later, all of them saying, you know, acorn-bearing oaks were a very important part of the diet of people back in those days. And of course, diet in those days wasn't, we didn't just eat one or two things. The great place to live in the Neolithic was in a vertical economy, a place that went from up in the mountains to down by the water, because you'd get different things. So this is actually where Eden was. This is the Tigris and Euphrates. You know, you realize that in Genesis it says, you can eat the fruit of every tree except one, and we always focus on the except one. But what if it wasn't a poetic manner of speaking to say you can eat the fruit of every tree? That people, in fact, did eat the fruit of every tree. And in this area where Eden was, oaks were very important in the uplands, and there's indication that there was a lot of eating in the Neolithic period, a lot of people eating from the oak tree. So it was very, very important. And it was also a way to get food fairly easily. The guy who studied the Eden landscape said that he calculated that people could get all the calories they needed without even working very hard. And that it's certainly true that the people in California, David Bainbridge, who really studied them for a long time, said they could get all the food they needed for 2 to 3 years in 2 to 3 weeks. So it was a kind of affluence that they were producing, and that produced an ability to reflect. So it made them able to do an extraordinary number of things with oak. This is an example of that system where I met that woman who gave me the acorns to eat. This is Dehesa, which is probably the oldest agroforestry system successfully working in the world. They have pollen evidence of them for 5,000 and 6,000 years ago. A lot of them still exist in western Spain. So people living in these, they were working on the basis of forests, but then abstracting from them and pollarding them, cutting them back repeatedly. And when they did, they learned all sorts of things that you could do with oak trees that you wouldn't necessarily think. For one thing, you can use a paste from the bark to cure your skins and make yourself clothing or make yourself boots out of. You can use that same paste to stop bleeding. It's an excellent wound dressing. There are galls on it that if you suck them, give off a sweet juice. Sometimes the sweet juices gather all over the leaves, and if you knock them off and put them in you can bake goods and make sweetened baked goods with them. All sorts of things they began to learn you could do with this. You could also, if you pollarded the trees, this is a pollarded ancient oak in one of these dehesas, cut it back repeatedly to places like that and that. You get reliable regrowth, and when you do these pieces you take down, you can use, sometimes they use them for wattle and daub for building purposes, but mainly they turn them into charcoal, which would allow them to make glass, would allow them to make iron, all kinds of other things. So lots and lots of different things could be done with them. This is one of the galls that occurs on the oak is Quercus infectoria. It's a gall that it was used to make the black ink that was used for most records all over Europe for about 500 years. And you know, so Da Vinci's drawings are done in oak gall ink. So the Quercus suber has a flexible bark that you can take off it without killing the tree that will then grow back and give you, as it grows, but you can take it and harvest it. It gives you something that will float, so you can have something to float your fish nets. And you can have things, corks to put in your wine bottles and all kinds of, so all of these things come off that one day. So, and of course, then there are the jamones ibéricos de bellota, the ham that they sell in Fairway for like $250 a pound. Jamón ibérico de bellota. That's Iberian hams finished in these dehesas. They go in and they eat the acorns when they're down. So a multi-use thing. And all this comes from people saying, hey, look, what can we do with this? What can we do with that? Having the affluence to be able to decide it. But one thing they certainly learned is that oak has a very particular structure. So it became extraordinarily important to building particularly in Europe and around the world, because it has this wonderful ring and ray system that you can see very clearly. You can see the rings, you can see the rays, and as the oak begins to dry, sometimes it begins to divide itself almost into board-like sections. So if even with a Neolithic axe, you could use it whole, you could knock the ends off it, you could do a tangential cut, that would be very laborious with a Neolithic axe, but you could also split it radially. You could cleave it just by sticking a wedge into the end of it and knocking out boards. So you could do half of it, quarter of it, down to very, very small boards. You know, our clapboards are usually thicker on one side than another. That's originally because they were cleft boards. Clapboard means a cleft board. This is where they're rebuilding Viking ships in Denmark, and you can see that's all cleft wood. That's wood where they've simply taken oak and cleft it along the ring of the rays. So people figured this out a long time ago, about 5,800 years ago in the Fens, which was another good vertical landscape, great place to live because you had everything from lowland fish and birds all the way up the hills. But the trouble with living on a fen is that if you want to go visit your friends, you got to walk around. It usually takes about 3 hours. About 5,800 years ago, somebody said, hey, we don't need to do that. What if we built a little walkway to go across the fence? The fen's not very deep, right? So they did, and they actually had coppiced wood, and they made these kind of X-shaped indentations, which they drove into the base, and then they cleft oak. And that's all cleft oak boards, which are then notched on the sides and used to make that walkway so that they can visit their friends in 10 minutes instead of 3 hours. So this is the beginning of kind of working with oak as a building material that goes a long way after that. This is a little bit later in the Bronze Age in Holland. You could probably buy this thing for $29.95 in Home Depot. But not then. And look at this beautiful joint structure here. It's got carpenter's joints, it's got a mortise and tenon joint combined with a lap joint. That's a fairly complex carpenter's joint, and it makes it extremely sturdy. This was 3800 BC. So in 3800 BC, using that very easy workability of oak, they were able to develop the beginning of complex structures. Now, if you were living up here, it was very unlikely that you would be able to make a walkway across these. This is the Sogne Fjord in western Norway. I tried to take a little dip in the Sogne Fjord. It goes down to about 12 feet within about 5 feet from the shore, and I don't know how deep it is in the middle. But to get across this, you really can't use a walkway. But you can cleave oak and do what the Viking peoples did here. The Sogne Fjord is, by the way, right about there. What the peoples here did was to build, using cleft oak, extraordinary ships, which if you lived anywhere else in the world, you did not want to see coming around the point towards you, because it usually meant that something bad was going to happen to you shortly. But with those boats, these people conquered Scotland, they conquered Ireland, the Shetlands, the Faroes, Iceland, Greenland. They reached the New World half a millennium before Columbus. They built Dublin. They built York in England. They ruled the east of England for 100 years. They founded Normandy, the Northman's land in France. They sailed down the Seine to Harry Paris. These boats really worked. And they were simply made out of cleft oak. This is an old one called the Gokstad ship, and you can see that it's line after line of cleft oak simply set in a good pattern. And they would be riveted. They were using iron rivets, one to another, and then they would drop a very light frame in it to keep it from coming apart. And that frame was usually made out of naturally found pieces of oak wood. Here's one being rebuilt in Denmark, and you can see where they've set the rivets, and basically then they will drop into it. They will cut out of natural branches the framing, and then drop the framing into the boat. So with these things, they were able to go around the world. And it was really the first instance of people being able to travel a great distance. And it was thanks to a relationship with oak trees. If you've got a boat and the wind comes up, you can always sail before the wind, but you can't if you've got a building. So building was another thing that oak was extraordinarily important for. The development of carpenter's joint was a real profound act of human imagination. A lot of it, particularly in Europe, was executed in oak. English historic carpentry. If you're nuts about these things, you have to have English historic carpentry. He would go into people's houses and, who had old barns and houses and say, excuse me, could I draw your joints? And English people, being very polite, didn't say, get out of my house. They said, have some tea. And then they figured out what he was doing. They said, oh, okay. So this is a 14th century. This is one scarf joint, which is to join two buildings across a beam that's holding up a barn from the 14th century that is still there. You can see the person who made this may not have been able to read or write, but look at the extraordinary imagination that went into the building of this. It's tongued and grooved so it can't twist. It's mitered so it can't twist this way. It's got, it's tongued and grooved, it's mitered, it's got pegging back through it, it's tabled so it's set in so it can't pull apart. You would have to work really hard to make that joint fail, and in fact, it hasn't failed in more than 600 years. So a lot of the carpentry that went on was very, very imaginative work, and you can see, even in ordinary houses, this is where they've used a single trunk by cutting it into several pieces to make the frame for a house. And there, I have friends who are cruck builders, this is called cruck house. There are friends of cruck builders now who prefer these to using actual dimensional lumber because they say it's stronger and won't over time begin to sag. Given the fact that there was so much experience with and so much imagination involved in the use of oak, it's little wonder that one of the great works of the Middle Ages is a roof made of oak. It's a 660-ton roof at the Westminster Hall. At the time, it was twice as large as anything else that had been made in England. And it's a roof, right? So it has to suffer the worst that wind and weather can give it. You can see the many different parts that go into making, this is just one of the arcades. That's the whole thing, right? So what they did when they built this is, there was an old building standing there where these hammer beams are, they had little supports. And they would keep the, also all up and down here, there were supports going down to the ground. And then when they finished assembling this entire structure, which took the better part of a year, they first assembled it all on the ground because it's all timber framed, then put it together. They then stood it up, and once it was all stood up, they kicked out those supports. I would have loved to have been there. I mean, when they kicked out the last support and the thing just stood. And the thing still stands there today, as firm as it stood there. But we have computers now, so people go and look, well, why does it stand up? Somebody proved in the late 90s that it stood up because everything was resting on these cornices, and the computer showed this definitively. They then went into the building and looked at it, and they saw that enough decay had occurred in some of them that the arches didn't even reach the cornices in about half the cases. So obviously it wasn't only, I'm sure it was important, the cornices were important, but other things were important too. So the imagination involved in building these is more than a manipulation of number. It's really an imagination of what might happen and how can I deal with it. So I'm saying that in this way, oak not only taught us to think, but it taught us to think creatively. You take that structure and set it upside down and set it across the sea at 14 knots, and you've got what amounts to the ship that was made out of oak that really was the first thing to join the entire world in one. There was a naval medal that was widely spread in England in the 18th and 19th century, whose motto was, Nec meta mihi qui terminis orbi, nothing stops me but the ends of the earth. And that was the truth of these ships. Although it took 60 acres of 100-year-old oaks to make one of these things, something that could carry 100 guns or 1,500 tons of cargo, you could with those literally go around the world, and this is the first time that the world was joined into a single place. So all of these pieces are found. You know, a Viking ship was 90% those strakes and then only 10% framing. Opposite it with the large English oak ships and the large ships, European oak ships, and not to mention ours when we got around to making them. They were made typically with 90% framing and 10% of other things. They would go out, this is a job that I would have loved to have had. You would go out with templates into the field and you would find the pieces of your ship in the trees in the field. So you'd go into a forest and look for them. There's a lot of thought that people say, oh, they shaped them. Generally speaking, until the late 19th century, they did not shape them. They found the shapes in the field because they had to be very strong. So there is a transom knee. There's an ordinary. There's a couple of ordinary knees for a ship. There's a stern, a stem post, futtocks, those things that are going up the side and holding the ship. All of these found in the forest itself. And then they would often reduce them. I mean, that's the scale of these things they were finding in the field, and they would put lines on them and cut them, And this is the origin of the phrase, hew to the line and let the chips fall where they may. It's the hewers who are hewing down these into shape. This is an example. They're now doing one using the original forest from which oak chips were built in northern Spain. They're now rebuilding one in the port near San Sebastian. And there they are kind of doing that reduction actually in the place where they're going to be using the ship for the same piece. The problem with being a forester, of course, is you have to be aware of all these different things that might be wrong with your wood, because if you start hewing to the line and you find, oh my God, there's a shake in it, then you throw it away. So you've wasted a lot of time and you've used a lot of labor. So there's a lot of skill involved in doing this, but it made really the largest, before the Industrial Revolution, the largest industrial employer in the world were the shipyards. And the shipyards were really an assembly of crafts, all based upon the use of oak to make large ships that could sail around the world. When it got to this country, we were just starting out, and the British had 900 ships in their navy and were by far the preeminent power in the world. And then we had the War of 1812. So we wanted to catch up, so we made 17 ships. And one of them, the Constitution, had to go out. This is going on the Constitution today. Constitution can still be found in a harbor directly across from Boston, and you can go visit it. It's still there. It was built quite some time ago. But it was built in a way that the British kind of didn't know about. They would tend to build their these structures. Structure like this, their futtocks would be 14, 18 inches apart. In the case of Constitution, the American ship, they were about 2 inches apart. And they were made of the hardest and heaviest oak there is, which is Quercus virginiana, live oak. So the framing was made of live oak, but the skin of the ship was made of New Hampshire white oak. So it was a North-South collaboration. When this ship finally, it actually had to run away from a British squadron, and because it was so well made, it escaped an entire squadron barely. And then met a British ship named Guerriere in single combat, and it got its nickname Old Ironsides because it was so strongly built that basically the broadsides from Guerriere didn't even put a hole in it. And Guerriere, on the other hand, was so seriously damaged, and they were not really very good at being, you know, the idea was to capture your opponent's ship. They hit it so many times it sank. So they dismasted it and then it sank. But this was kind of the apotheosis for us of the use of oak. Unfortunately, we were kind of at the very tail end of it. Lots and lots of half the oak ships built in history were built in the 19th century. But in 1862, during the Civil War, a fellow came in who said, we'll just make them out of iron. So he made a ship called the Cumberland. The Confederates made a ship called the Cumberland, which his captain said looked like the roof of a barn afloat. So he sailed right towards a huge, beautiful oak ship of the line, ran right through it, and it sank. So that was kind of the end of oak as a strategic material for these purposes. The other problem with oak was, of course, if you don't use it and it just sits there, the hold tends to be nice and moist and wonderful for fungi, particularly dry rot fungi. So you would find a lot of ships that were sailing, not only warships, but ordinary merchant ships and even passenger ships that were sailing across the ocean would sometimes never be heard from again. And it wasn't necessarily hostile action. They might simply have sailed off their bottoms because there was so much decay in the hold and it was caused by this. There was a famous case called the Royal George. There were a lot of women and children, the sailors' wives and children, as well as Admiral Kempenfelt and very important dignitaries aboard the Royal George in harbor at Spithead when it simply fell apart and sank and everyone was lost. So oak as a strategic material had its limitations. So nowadays, you know, we don't use oak for as many things. We still use it for floorboards. We use it for other things. But we're now learning a tremendous amount from it. This is one of the dotards, one of the ancient oaks, probably from the 1588 planting that still exists in Windsor Great Park. They were going to take these down. And then Ted Green and some of his friends came out and said, "No, the hell you are." And they were the first people who kind of tied themselves around the trees and said, "No, you're not taking them out. These are very important." And from them, they've begun to study, from these and other, not only oaks, but oaks have been very important because they tend to live so long, to study in Europe in particular, and now over here as well, the kind of life cycle of a tree and how it will grow up, repeat and make an architectural pattern, then repeat that pattern in different ways, and then begin to grow down again a little at a time so that we end up with something that looks like this, really like this or like this. And that those are all stages in the lifetime of a tree, and that we as arborists and people taking care of trees can think these are important stages too. And if we can learn to keep a tree in this kind of situation so that it will not be too dangerous to people, well, we ought to try to do that, because trees are not like us. They don't get old and then die. They get old, they live a long time, and then they get smaller, so they don't die quickly. Also, this is I'm grateful to Dave Strauss for sending me this. I've been very interested in the fact that the New York City Parks Department, you know, when I started in this business, we would plant pin oaks, sometimes swamp white oaks, and a little bit of red oak. Not much else in New York City. Now there are 21 varieties of oak that are species and variety of oak that are being planted in New York City. And according to this is Nave's assessments of them, most all with pretty good health. Many of the ones that have English oak in them have problems with powdery mildew. But most of them are doing very well. So we're using these widely in New York City. Now, one good thing about them is I've noticed, we work in Madison Square Park, and one of the things I've noticed is that even though oaks don't like shade in the long run, they like nurse trees to start with. They like to be started with a little bit of shade, so they can be very good trees to start when you have some shade around them. They also have a good solid cuticle on the leaf, which makes it very hard to screw with when all the terrible winds that come down a city street occur. So a good tree to use in do I have a second? Okay. A good thing to use in New York City and elsewhere, and so we're using more and more of them, but now we have all these problems to have to deal with these. And I just want to make one more thought about, I'm hoping that I'm going to learn a lot about this from the speakers who are following. A thing happened in the Neolithic called the Neolithic elm fall. There were lots and lots of elm trees. See, here they are. Here's their pollen. And then all of a sudden, they're none, down almost to zero. There were a lot of theories about why that happened. But one of the main theories now is it happened because of the Neolithic axe, because people began to be able to cut pollard these trees. And when you do that at the wrong time, you attract bark beetles, and those bark beetles may very well be carrying what we now call Dutch elm disease. So the thought is that these elm trees perished all at once in such a short time, largely because of that, because of mistimed pruning, basically. So we now know a lot better about that, and one of the things I'm looking forward to learning is how in our practices, we can somehow at least prevent this happening with our oaks in the coming years, now that we have to deal with all these new problems. This is an old oak pollard forest in the north of Spain. These trees are probably about 300 or 400 years old, but they're replacing trees that were there since the 10th century. This is what a woodland really looked like in Europe, all over Europe, and pretty much all over the world, for at least since the early Middle Ages, and in many cases since the Neolithic. People would cut the wood and use it, let it grow again, and I very much hope that we are going to have woodlands like this and woodlands like our woodlands of oaks that have really never been pruned for the future. So we'll figure out how to do that. Anyway, thank you all very much. All right, well, thank you all very much for being here, braving the storm today. It's great to see all these fans of oak, and it's really a great pleasure to be here with these other experts and follow somebody like Bill. So thank you. I'm looking forward to George and Neil and Gretchen's talks as well. I'm going to talk about the ecological role of oaks, their importance in ecosystem function. Talk a little bit about some threats and then about a particularly cool experiment, I think, that I and some colleagues have been doing in Black Rock Forest for the last 10 years. That really speaks to the ecological importance of oak trees. So oaks are important for a number of reasons. Ecologically, they dominate such a large proportion of the eastern United States. They're really the most important tree taxon if we think about the range of their dominance. Circled here in white, this is adapted from Lucy Braun's original map. They've actually increased their area of dominance to the north here. So they've done quite well. So our oak forests are spatially extremely important, and then temporally as well, they've dominated since basically the retreat of the glaciers. So this is a pollen profile from Black Rock Forest that goes back on the axis here to 10,000 years ago after the retreat of the glaciers. You can see pollen by different taxa. The oak taxa here are, this is everything, red plus white plus chestnut plus all the others. But you can see shortly after the retreat of the glaciers, oaks came on big time, and their pollen is continuously very abundant through the record. So huge spatial importance, huge temporal importance, and all the ecosystems then have become adapted to this dominance by oak. Among its important ecological roles is the absorption and storage of carbon. We published this several years ago. Oak trees store carbon, take it up, and hold it longer than any other species of trees in our forests. This is from a couple of hundred trees, Black Rock Forest's long-term records back to the 1930s. We start out, starting out back here in the 1930s, a couple hundred trees of six different species, all about the same size. And you can see what's happened. The oak species, particularly red oak and chestnut oak, is quite common at Black Rock Forest. But the white oak growth rates are the same. They just outstrip all the others. This is the scale of biomass. But for oak trees, the dry biomass is about 50% carbon. So they're also taking up lots of carbon out of the atmosphere and storing it. And we haven't published it yet, but their long-term storage, even after they die, also outstrips all the other species. So they play a tremendously important role in the carbon cycle and in helping keep carbon out of the atmosphere. They're also hugely important in nitrogen cycling. As little as 20% oak in an ecosystem, according to work by Kathy Weathers, and this is from Gary Lovett, Kathy Weathers, and Mary Arthur, published several years ago. Every species, and here's half a dozen examples, have their own importance with respect to nutrient cycling, especially nitrogen, one of the most important elements in our forests. And if we look at these last several nitrogen cycling, the extractable nitrogen in the soils, mineralization, nitrification rates, nitrogen leaching, we can see something like maple is profligate with nitrogen. It turns over very rapidly and can even run off and be lost in nitrogen leaching from the soils of maple ecosystems. If we look at oak-dominated ecosystems, it's just the opposite. Much lower rates of turnover, much more conservation of nitrogen within the ecosystem, and hardly ever any nitrogen leaching at all. Another important feature of oaks for the ecosystem is the ubiquitous acorn, so iconic of these ecosystems, and it's a tremendously important source of hard mass energy for many, many species. It's readily available, it's higher energy resource, it's consumed by at least in our area 96 species of mammals and birds, and it was great to hear from Bill that there's 1,000 or more species of insects also that are dependent on oaks. Some species live their entire life cycle within acorns, for example. They do cycle, they mast periodically, and that can tend to drive the cycles of many of the other forest animals, the ones that feed on the acorns, the prey, the predators that feed on them, etc. So hugely tied into the organisms in forests, and this hard mast has been especially important since the loss of American chestnut. So acorns are now the most important hard mast species east of the Mississippi River, and with beech decline becoming even more so over time. So hugely important for other animals, and because of all these features, oaks have been termed foundation species or foundation taxa, because really the oaks are more similar than they are different. Each species has its own ecology, but as a group, they're foundation taxa, and that means they're locally very abundant. They dominate ecosystems, and as a result of their function in these ecosystems, they do two key things: modulate core ecosystem processes, so they control processes like the nitrogen and carbon cycling I gave an example of, and they're also hugely important for other organisms, so they have characteristics that create habitat for a large number of other species. So these ecosystems are strongly adapted, both the process and the components, to the presence of oaks. And we wondered, having a forest, Black Rock Forest, that's 70% oak, more or less, as foundation taxa, if oaks were lost, how would this change ecosystem function? How would it change the processes? What effect would it have on the different organisms? So that kind of plays into our question of what is the ecological importance and role of oak trees. A short list of current challenges, so it's not just of academic interest, because oaks and forests in general have lots of issues they're facing. Regeneration failure, especially in oak populations in the eastern United States, changes to the biogeochemistry, acid rain, nitrate deposition, etc., ever-increasing influxes of exotic organisms, reductions of biological diversity, fragmentation, disturbance regime changes, suppression of fire, etc., and overlaid on all this, a continuing change of climate. So there are very serious challenges to these oak-dominated ecosystems, And what's at service? Well, what's at stake? What do we get out of these? Well, you heard a lot of it from Bill, but you know, our forests clean our air and water, provide timber and pulp, sustain native plants and animals, control nutrient cycling, local climate, etc. And so again, will a new generation of forests, if we were to lose our oaks, our other trees, our other forests, able to provide those same services? Again, not just academic interest, but we have noticed in our records, long-term records since the 1930s, mortality, canopy mortality, has been about 1% of basal area per year over time. That's what's kind of typical for these oak forest ecosystems, occasionally jumping up to 2 or 3 when we have outbreaks of gypsy moth or serious drought. But in the early 2000s, we noted mortality rates per year were running up to 3 or 4% of the canopy trees, signaling potential for a major change. So again, very important to track. Now that's come back down since then, I'm happy to say, but maybe going back up. Among the challenges, there's climate change. This is a map showing the range in the light kind of mustard color here, the range of sugar maple right now, and projected by the Forest Service models by the end of the century, these few darker patches are the only places sugar maple is projected to be left if the climate continues to change. Sugar maple being gone for our forests would be a major change. Now, oaks, according to these models, and each map is different for each species, but oaks are actually expected to benefit from the warming of the climate and move further northward, but that's by no means certain. Climate change carries with it many other changes as well, to precipitation and temperature regimes, to the organisms that are in there. So certainly we have to keep in mind the changing climate and how that may affect the future role of oaks. Another major thing that we've been focusing on at Black Rock Forest and is a concern through much of the range of oaks is regeneration failure. In many places, oaks are just not regenerating. And obviously, they've been able to do so tremendously successfully for the last 10,000 years. They've reproduced by seed, they've reproduced by sprouts, etc. And yet, in many cases, oaks are not replacing themselves at all in oak-dominated forests. A key feature of this is our trophic imbalance, having eliminated predators in many systems. Herbivores have got no top-down control anymore, and the populations of some organisms, particularly white-tailed deer, which love to eat oak seedlings, have exploded and are a major reason for regeneration failure. We know this in a place like Black Rock Forest. We have a couple dozen deer exposures that we put up, both for research experimental questions, but also to help regenerate tree species in the forest in the face of deer over-herbivory. And this is one 8-year-old fenced exposure. You can see plenty of tree seedlings coming in on the inside, maple, beech, birch, but also oak seedlings coming in over time. There are just as many seedlings outside of this fence here. They're just all ankle high. They've been repeatedly browsed. So this is a serious concern. I'm happy to say, though, an important background here. We've been tracking deer population levels in our forest for many decades. And they increased and went kind of crazy during the 1970s and 80s. These are numbers of this overwinter minimum population size, and at 20 to 35 deer per square mile at a minimum, that goes up to 50 or more per square mile during the growing season after the fawns are born. You just can't get tree regeneration. Every winter they'll browse the seedlings too much. But when the experiment I'll tell you about, it's been going on for 10 years, started in 2007, deer were up here at about 20 per square mile. For 10 years, we've had decline in the deer population, and in the last 5 years, our population levels have been at 10 to 12 deer per square mile, and we are getting tree regeneration across much of the Black Rock Forest. It's a wonderful thing to come to work nowadays and see finally trees regenerating in this ecosystem, and we know that the deer have been playing a major role. Other threats, and of course we'll hear more about this today, and it's one of the reasons for this conference, is pests and pathogens that can have major effects. Certainly we've lost entire tree species like chestnut to the chestnut blight in the past. And there seems to be, you know, practically every year there's a new pest or pathogen spreading that we hear about. This is from California, oak tree that was killed by sudden oak death, and you can see its mechanism of action. It gets into the wood and kills the wood from the outside in and girdles the tree, kills the cambium, clogs kills the phloem, clogs the xylem, and the above ground part of the tree dies off. This is pretty similar to the way that chestnut blight killed trees. and is a real matter of concern. So it's called girdling, like a girdle, tight girdle, cutting off your flow of nutrients around the circumference of the tree. We don't have sudden oak death in the East, I think, and hope that it maybe cannot actually be sustained in our ecosystem, but in California it's been killing hundreds of thousands of oak trees. More recently, oak wilt. So just last year, oak wilt was found in six parts of New York State. There had been a previous infestation, also a seventh one up here, which was controlled, and I think we'll hear more about oak wilt. But it's also a fungal disease. Without a cure, you basically have to find the trees, kill them. And I'm particularly concerned about the pattern of where we're finding it now. So lots in our New York City area, lots out in Long Island, other places in upstate. It's believed to be spread primarily by beetles and by root grafts, but beetles and root grafts isn't how it got to these locations. And I'm just hoping that it is not more widespread, but it may be something we've got to be more concerned about in the future. So for all these reasons, 10 years ago, we designed an experiment we call the Future of Oak Forests, also known as the Oak Removal, and we wanted to see what would be the effect. What is the importance of oak in these ecosystems by taking it out and see what the effects are? Black Rock Forest is a good location in which to do this. It's an experimental research forest, almost 4,000 acres in size in New York's Hudson Highlands, largely undeveloped. Records going back to the 1930s, as you've seen, and it is a field station for 21 different academic institutions for education and research. So there are about 10 of us who have been working on this experiment. Here's where Black Rock is, up the Hudson River, about an hour, and within this 4 million acre New York, New Jersey highlands region, which is all oak dominated, at least the uplands of this entire area are oak dominated. So Black Rock Forest is a relatively representative site of this entire 4 million acre region. There are numerous investigators who have been working with over the years in this. Shahid Naeem was here yesterday speaking. He's one of the PIs. Kevin Griffin from Columbia, Kathy Weathers, Jerry Melillo, Matt Palmer, and a number of graduate students who you'll see who have been working on this project. As I said, begun about 10 years ago, of interest in quantifying the role of oaks in our ecosystem and concern about their possible loss. So here's the experimental area. It's about 15 acres in the central area, and I want you to focus on these plots here in the center is where I'll be showing you most of the results. Each plot is about 1.3 acres in size, 75 meters on a side, and each has been treated in one of four different ways. The C is a control plot, and we've got three rows of the treatments going up the slope. At the base of the slope here, we can see a control plot, 75 meters by 75 meters, studied beforehand and then not manipulated. The O plots, or OG, are 100% oak girdled. We used a chainsaw to mimic death by pathogen by girdling around the circumference of the tree and killing the above ground part of all the oaks on these plots. Mostly I'll be talking about results from these two types of treatments, but also you should know there's an O50 plot wherein we girdled every other oak tree to see if the impacts of losing oak were linear or not. And then finally a series of plots N or NOG where we girdled all the non-oak trees. So after the treatment in 2008, these plots vary from 0% oak to 100% oak. And we've tracked numerous things since then. There was one plot where we actually girdled every tree. We didn't want to do that too much, but I'll show you a little bit of results from the all girdled plot. It looks like, well, I don't know what it looks like. Nothing you've ever seen before. And then here's the plot design. Each plot, as I said, is 75 meters on a side. That breaks down to 9 25 meter by 25 meter subplots. Most of the data are gathered in the central 25 meter by 25 meter subplot so as to avoid edge effects from the nearby treatments. So you're always 25 meters in. We studied every oak tree and every non-oak tree in this central area and also every oak tree on every subplot over time and a series of other measurements as well. Oh, and then another factor, because the deer are so important, within each plot, we put in a fenced deer exclosure, approximately 10 meters by 15 meters on a side. I don't have time today to get into a lot of those results, but the deer really mediate disturbance and recovery responses in this ecosystem. I'll show you a couple of things that have come out of that fencing experiment. Key measurements, a series of things with respect to the environmental parameters, the other plant and tree species, biogeochemical cycling processes and then impacts on various other organisms in the ecosystem. This is what the whole, those 12 plots look like altogether. The trees that we've studied in the brown are the oak trees, in the light blue or in the center of each plot, the non-oaks that we tracked. We've been tracking a total of 7,554 trees for 10 years. It's a lot of work, but it's fun, and about 20 different species altogether. So in terms of results, first of all, oak has a major impact on the environmental parameters that are important to other organisms. So of course, if you open up the canopy, if you kill canopy trees, you get more light in. As you can see here, over the years, consistently more light on these OG or oak girdled plots, but maybe not as much as you might think. These measurements are taken at 1 meter above the ground, and there are sub-canopy trees, there's shrub layer, et cetera, that actually intercepts a lot of this light. So a lot of the changes are taking place below the level of the canopy, but there's still more light reaching the ground. And in addition, water and temperature regimes change as well. So within the soils, if we look here at the soil water content on the control plots, this is an average for a summer. After the treatment, about 10% water content, same with the non-oak girdle plot. But if we look here at the O50 and oak girdle plots, the water content is over 2 times higher, almost 25%. So the trees have been taking so much water out of the soils, I thought the soils were going to get hotter. In fact, they stay wetter, and as a result, are also cooler. So by losing oaks from the ecosystem, all the major environmental drivers, the temperature regime, the moisture regime, and the light regime are all significantly different. Now, one of the first things that we noticed on the plots was a change in the carbon cycling rate in terms of the respiration coming out of the soils. So on these plots here, this is loss or reduction in CO2 coming off of the soils, 50% lower after the girdling. That means of the life below ground, about 50% of it is directly attributed to the oaks, their roots, or the mycorrhizae and other organisms directly associated with the oaks. So the very interesting finding, 50% loss of respiration after the treatment. The effect went on for 3 years before it came back up. Interestingly, the O50 and non-oak girdle plots had much lower, actually not different statistically from zero, reduction of respiration. And we think part of it is when you don't lose every oak tree, a lot of the roots stay alive, a lot of the mycorrhizal connections stay alive. But when you lose either all trees or your O, or 100% of your oaks, that mycorrhizal root mat essentially dies off. Another result with nitrogen, exactly what we thought we would find, we did. Here's the control levels of mineral nitrogen in the soil over time through the course of the experiment. Here's when the girdling went in on the oak girdle plots, much higher levels of nitrogen. So that's going to create a competition, a scrambling for the extra nitrogen in the system. This is in the form of nitrate. That went up a lot. Ammonium went up as well. Again, the effect tended to trail off over time. But on those 100% oak girdled plots, there was actually loss of nitrogen from the system, losing a key nutrient in terms of nitrate leaching from the sites. Now, let me show you some effects on the trees. First of all, explain how this diagram works. We're looking at total trees in this graph in terms of kilograms per hectare. The axes are plots are in general about 250,000 kilograms of biomass per hectare. And here's the roughly 10 years the experiment's been going on. Here's where we girdled the plots. And the control plots continue to increase, about a 13% biomass increase over time. In the purple, the O50, we lost, let's see, about 28% of the biomass. On the non-oak girdle plots, about 13%. And on the oak girdle plots, 78%. Just to give you an idea of the magnitude of the treatment and how much biomass was removed, how big of a change these treatments were. And what are the effects? Well, first let's take a look at how the oaks responded to this. Again, I showed you on the control plots, they just, you know, nothing was done. They continued to grow. 13% total increase in biomass over that time. On the non-oak girdle plots, so we took out everything. These are 100% oaks now. The remaining oak trees did not grow any faster. In fact, they grew kind of slower. So apparently the non-oaks are not really competitors for resources with the oak trees. And really surprisingly, on the O50 plots,
they only increased 4% in biomass over the same period of time. You would think maybe with every other competitor gone, the trees would grow faster. Maybe 120-year-old oak trees just don't have that kind of a release or response. But that's an interesting result we found for the way the oaks respond. But more germane to our question, how the other species without oak in the ecosystem change. On the control plots, and this is all the species lumped together, on the control plots, as you see here, they increased 18% in biomass over time. So a little faster growth rate than the oaks. On the 050 plots, where every other tree was taken out, it was twice as fast, so they definitely responded. They were being competed with by the oaks and were released, and especially on the oak girdled plots, the fully oak girdled plots, a 100% increase in biomass over 8 years, a quadrupling of their growth rate. And this effect continues today. These are data that we've just analyzed from the last year. Still an increased effect continuing on after 8 years. So loss of oak has a major effect on different species. What are those different species and how are they varying? After 3 years, we published a paper, Nancy Falxa-Raymond and others, on how the birches were responding. And again, we found this general pattern of increased rate on 050 plots, but especially increased rate, over 100% biomass in increase in 3 years on the oak girdled plots. So black birch appears to be primed to be able to take advantage of this. One of the things is that there's new nitrate available, nitrogen in the form of nitrate available in the soils. Not all species are able to take that up and use it. Apparently black birch is. But we've just analyzed the data for the other species and found that black birch is not the big winner here. Here we've got, there are only four tree species that are common enough to be statistically significantly evaluated across these plots over time, and they're sugar maple, red maple, black gum or tupelo, and black birch. And you can see them here in each case, the line, the flat line is the control plot for each, and the squares indicate the oak girdled line. You can see relatively flat growth of these non-oak species over time, slight upturn. Without any treatment, black birch generally has the highest growth rate of the non-oak trees on these plots. But with girdling, the increase was dramatic, up to 5 or 10 times faster growth by these other species, and the biggest increases were red and sugar maple. Red maple tripled its growth rate, and sugar maple doubled its growth rate. So they're clearly able to take up that extra nitrogen in the soil and benefit from it and use the extra water and light. Interestingly, in the shrub layer, so this is new results, just came out last year, Canadian Journal Forest Research, witch hazel goes crazy. So oak death significantly increased light and nitrogen. In response, witch hazel ramped up all of its physiological functions that they were able to track, photosynthesis, respiration, etc. It increased stem growth of witch hazel by 334% and spread as well. So if you go into these girdle plots now, witch hazel is a much more important controlling feature in the understory. And as a result, they concluded if large-scale oak mortality does occur, witch hazel will be an important competitor for light and soil resources. The response of this shrub to improved understory conditions may help shape which species replace the oaks in the canopy. So they're going to have a controlling role, especially on the seedlings of the next generation of trees coming in. And looking at those seedlings, again, we've just gotten these data and begun to analyze them. So looking at all the woody seedlings total, back in 2008 here in the black, you see we had a distribution of seedlings dominated by red maple and not much of anything else. But 8 years later after the treatment, yeah, red maple is still the most common, but now we've got lots more diversity coming in the seedlings. We have lots of black birch, lots of white ash, tulip poplar, and really nice to see the oaks actually able to come back here, increase in both chestnut oak and red oak seedlings. All right, other organisms. There were dramatic changes in the microbial and mycorrhizal communities below ground. We haven't yet published these results except for some very early results, but there was a dramatic loss in the species of mycorrhizae directly adapted to oaks, dependent on them. And then after 3 years, a rebound in the microbial community, but we think it's reorganized with a very different species mix below ground. Obviously, that's going to have a huge impact on function, In terms of other organisms, if we look at the mesofauna or organisms living in the top layers of the soil and the soil litter, they were really upset with the oak girdling. So the most abundant organisms were mites, followed by springtails, and two-thirds of them were lost. These are the control plots over here, fenced and unfenced. But the key thing here was once they were girdled, these organisms dropped off dramatically. Now this is especially true in the litter layer. The litter layer did get drier. While the soil stayed moister, the litter layer got drier and was less beneficial to a lot of organisms like this. Other insects, ticks, I'm afraid it's really inconclusive. We thought perhaps with the loss of oaks and the stop of acorn crops, we would have fewer ticks over time, but that doesn't seem to be the case. We don't have a significant change at all in tick populations, and that's probably related to some of the small mammal dynamics. So with the small mammals, the biggest impact that we saw was a reduction in diversity over time, especially specialist species. We lost voles, we lost shrews, flying squirrels seemed to go down, but some of the more generalist species didn't really seem to matter. So the white-footed mouse, for example, was there a change over time? No significant difference. How about by species? Well, there was a trend towards increase on the fully oak-girdled plots. They switched their diet. They weren't dependent on acorns anymore. They were eating the insects and other things in there. And that may be why the tick populations didn't go down, since white-footed mice are the main vectors of ticks. And then one more organism, eastern chipmunk, another generalist and kind of similar pattern, did not change over time, did not significantly vary by treatment, although there was a tendency on the most disturbed plots, the ones that were really open and became drier, chipmunks populations did decrease. So I will summarize. Are oaks ecologically important? Yes, very much. And our results indicate the following seven or eight features. They represent a high proportion of the biomass of the forest that they're in. So they control lots of the processes in these. They control a lot of what other species are able to survive and thrive under their canopy. They have very high carbon uptake rates. They produce a lot of wonderful wood. And they sequester it for many decades. We have dead oak trees going back to the 1960s that are still present in the forest. They control forest nitrogen cycling, probably the most important nutrient in the forest. They play a dominant role in the water cycle, as you saw. They cycle so much of it through their transpiration stream. They support characteristic soil microbes, and especially mycorrhizal, ectomycorrhizal fungi. They host characteristic guilds of invertebrates on the trees, in the litter, in the soil. And they provide food and habitat for a complex food web of many organisms adapted to oaks, especially in the mammals and birds, but also in the insects. So are they ecologically important? Absolutely. And that's all I've got. Thank you.
So in the afternoon, again, it was late morning, we have a slightly different focus. George Hudler is a plant pathologist who's had a distinguished career at Cornell University, where he was chair of the plant pathology department and director of the Northeast Regional Center for the National Plant Diagnostic Network. Say that one time fast. He will discuss some of the diseases that are increasingly impacting the health of our oaks. Gretchen Pettis, an entomologist at the Bartlett Tree Research Laboratories, will discuss insects that impact oak health. And Neil Hendrickson, also from Bartlett, will cover some of the best practices for keeping our oaks healthy in the light of all the stresses we have learned about. As a reminder, when the presentation concludes, we will have a brief question and answer session. So until then, please enjoy, and here's George Hudler.
Well, thanks very much. I know that at the beginning of this conference, you were admonished to turn off your cell phones. I have to tell you that I just turned mine on and set the timer so that I kind of keep track of how fast I'm going. I hope I've got all the other audio turned off here. I'm not expecting any phone calls, but if we do, I'll squash them as quickly as possible. I don't know about you, but three, 4 weeks ago, we had a conference call with the speakers on this program. And I thought I had a sense of what to expect when I walked in the door here. But based on what I've heard so far, I'm really blown away. And among other things, I'm sitting down here and I'm thinking, I want to raise my hand. I want to ask a question. I want to get clarification. And I suspect you are too. And I hope that we're going to be able to have that kind of opportunity And if it doesn't play out quite this way, maybe there's a way we can invite people to send questions that could be appear in some post-conference something or other. But I feel like I'm learning a lot, and I'm supposed to be an expert here, and I don't know. There's a lot going on. So I'm going to focus my attention on three particular tree diseases, diseases that affect oaks. But you need to know right up front that there are hundreds and hundreds of microorganisms that live on oaks, and many of them do cause disease, but the diseases are really insignificant in terms of overall tree health. Some of them make the trees look bad temporarily, and I think particularly of leaf diseases that will cause for this. Every maybe 5 years we have what we call a wave year of infection, and we get a massive amount of a leaf disease like oak leaf blister or anthracnose or something else, and people get a little bit hysterical for the short run, but we know from experience that these things are going to subside, and more importantly, we know that they, by and large, will pose no threat whatsoever to the overall survival of the tree. Now, that's not necessarily true with insects, but with diseases, that's the case. And so I'm not going to spend time talking about those kinds of things. What I'm really going to focus on are three that do present what we think is a pretty grave situation, or at least something that deserves a lot of concern from the scientific world, but it also deserves attention from folks like you, the boots on the ground, the people who see our patients day after day after day. And there's just nothing that beats your experience as we try to work together as a team to right the ship here. So the first disease I want to talk about is oak wilt. I know this is a hot item down here, and as whenever I tell a story, I always like to try to start at the beginning. And in the case of oak wilt, the beginning appears to be way back in 1881, where somebody stumbled across a description more recently written of some decline of oaks in Wisconsin. And in retrospect, you look at how the symptoms were playing out and everything, that does appear to maybe have been the first documented record of oak wilt. But the profession was not well organized, the communication wasn't all that great, so it didn't cause a lot of alarm beyond the guy who chose to write that. But by 1942, things had gotten considerably more interesting. This mysterious decline had spread into much more of southwestern Wisconsin, southeastern Minnesota, and a bit of Iowa. And by this time, we did in fact know that there was a microorganism involved. Today we call it Ceratocystis fagaciarum. It had a different name at the time, but we don't need to worry about that. And in fact, I think the common name oak wilt had emerged at that time as well. Now, I grew up in northern Minnesota and was doing my schooling in the late 60s, early 70s. For those of you of my generation, you will understand, well, the late 60s weren't as intellectually productive as the early 70s. But that was attributable to some other pharmacological things that we don't need to dwell on. Nonetheless, by the 1973, I was teaching, I was the head TA of our forest pathology class at the University of Minnesota. And so I taught about all kinds of things for semesters. And oak wilt was always hot on the topic because my major professor was very much interested in it. The real hot spot had spread, but then there was additional reports of oak wilt beyond that initial area and even out here into the east. But I need to point out when I show this that in the Midwest, in the red area there, oak wilt was really killing trees in large numbers and in infection centers, which I'll talk a bit more about in a minute. And the disease was reported from other sites here. People would stumble onto it. They would do the necessary diagnostic tests. But sometimes it was just like one tree in a county. But when the map was created, the whole county got colored in. And so this really shouldn't leave you to think that, yeah, oak wilt was rampant out here at all, because it wasn't. And in fact, in most cases, virtually all cases, when the tree was found to be diseased and confirmed to have oak wilt, they went in, they would cut the tree down, just cut that tree down, and things seemed to stop right there. We don't know why, But it would appear that at least at that time in history, the environment just wasn't, it just wasn't quite conducive for the more rapid spread. But at the same time in the early 70s, we began to hear rumblings about this mysterious decline of oaks down in Texas. And people scratched their heads over that for quite a long time, until for another 4 or 5 years, when in fact, oak wilt was also then confirmed in much of central Texas, and it remains a real serious problem down there as well. It plays out symptomologically quite different from what we see here, and the rest of my remarks are going to be focused mainly on what's going on in the Northeast. So what are you looking for if you suspect a tree has oak wilt? One of the first symptoms that you will see, and I apologize for this picture, but the thing is that the leaves will have a conspicuous marginal scorch. Now, this is pretty uniform. It's not always that uniform. It's can be erratic around the edge. And you'll see the scorch with the inner part not near so bronze. It might be a much lighter green color. These leaves, by the time I finally got to take a picture, had been in a plastic bag a little too long. But the other thing is, you see some premature leaf drop, but the big thing is, it's fast. That between the time you first see symptoms like leaf scorch on the leaves and the time things progress, it can be as short as 2, maybe 3 weeks, certainly within 6 weeks, trees will go from completely healthy, can go from completely healthy to completely dead, and that this is kind of an unusual thing for oaks. The other thing is that you'll see vascular discoloration, maybe, and boy do I have to enforce that, because when I learned about oak wilt, when I taught about oak wilt, I was also teaching about Dutch elm disease. And one of the diagnostic features for Dutch elm disease was to peel back the bark of the suspect twig, and the discoloration in the xylem was so obvious you couldn't miss it. In fact, you probably could stop right there in any further diagnostic tests. We usually didn't, but you probably could because it was that reliable. That is just not the case with oak wilt. Sometimes it is real conspicuous, like you see here, or in this picture as well. But more often, as I'll show you a little bit later, it is not near as obvious. It can be confused with a lot of other things, or it may not be there at all. And so when we get around to eventually taking samples and submitting them for a laboratory assay, as far as I'm concerned, if you find some discoloration, anything that resembles this, that's great. But if you don't find it, you can't just write off oak wilt as a possibility. Oh, great. I just threw these in this morning because that reminds me to tell you that in the case of oak wilt, red oaks are by far and away the most susceptible to this disease. White oaks get oak wilt, but the disease doesn't progress anywhere near as rapidly. The trees actually seem to have a little bit of resistance or tolerance. Red oaks, on the other hand, can undergo this very rapid symptom expression. And here's why. This is a picture of white oak wood, and you notice there looks like all these little gluey plugs here. These are called, you guys are in horticulture school, what are they called? I'm sorry, they didn't want me to know they were in the front row here. Tyloses, good for you. And these are actually, this is protoplasm that oozes out into the xylem from adjacent cells. I'm sorry, guys, I didn't really mean to do that to you. But I am a professor, and I do like to tighten the screws now and then. Okay, but if you even take a little closer look at those then. So white oak, this is normal white oak. And there, this seems to be so common, you might wonder, how in the heck does stuff get from the bottom to the top of the tree or the other way around with all that plugging? Well, somehow it does, and I can't really tell you for sure. But this tylosis is there, and among other things, these occasional plugs in the xylem vessels help to slow down or mediate the movement of stuff. Now you get red oak, which we know is highly susceptible to oak wilt, and it's like looking down a bunch of soda straws. I mean, those things are so big and wide open, you don't worry about falling in when you look at them. And this is what happens. When oak wilt gets into the xylem, and that's where it does its thing, in the xylem, of susceptible trees, and especially susceptible red oaks. It sporulates. The spores can be carried rapidly up and down the tree, and so it's really a very, this is really, from my perspective, what explains that rapid spread. And then the other thing, from a diagnostic standpoint, and really this was so much more obvious in my upbringing in Minnesota than I see here, is that oak wilt occurs typically in infection centers. So that you, this is the aerial view of this area near a Minnesota farmland, but you see this pie, this group of infected trees, and if you came back next year and took the same picture, it would be even bigger. Well, the reason for that is that oaks are interconnected. The root systems are interconnected. They graft very, very readily with each other. I happen to think that it's not just grafts of red oaks to red oaks or red oaks to others in the red oak group, but there may even be opportunities for grafting between different species of oaks. So in any case, but it does happen. Oak roots are prolific. They spread a long ways out from the crown. I say here up to 50 feet. Down in Texas, they would probably tell you that's two or three times that you get this kind of potential. And as we see, the pathogen then in the xylem of those that wood spreading through the crown of whatever tree is affected also can spread through those root grafts to adjacent trees and give us those infection centers. Okay, and then finally, if you're lucky enough, you may actually see signs of the pathogen. And the signs are the spore-producing bodies. Now, this, I think, is just such a fascinating reproductive strategy for this pathogen. But once a tree is dead or nearly dead, within about 6 months or so, on the surface of the wood, that interface between the wood and the bark, the fungus will produce sterile pads. And they are sterile. They're masses of fungus tissue pretty much hard as a rock. And so you've got one of these being produced in the inner bark, one on the wood, and they press against each other with such force that they actually split the bark open. Now you think the tree has been dead for 6 months, let's say, but the bark, you know, red oak, that bark is still on, tighter than a drum. And the idea that this fungus could produce that much pressure to crack that open is just amazing. And so what you get is a crack like this. Wow, that by itself is, I mean, you could walk by those all the time. It wouldn't draw any attention. But if you take time to open it up, then around that so-called, those pressure pads, we find what we call a mycelial mat. And that's where that fungus is producing its spores. And not only, here's another picture. So here again, the pressure pads, here's this mycelial mat. And the spores in there are thick. And they're sticky, but more importantly than anything else, they smell good. They smell like stale beer, and that odor then oozes out of the cracks in the bark. And what does it? What's the function there? Well, I'm labeling those the fertile spore-bearing mycelia, the sterile pressure pads. They attract insects that are attracted to rotting fruit and other sweet smells. And in particular, they attract nidodulid beetles. Nidodulid beetles are generally kind of lazy. When they are attracted to these oak wilt pressure pads or mats, they'll crawl into the cracks, and quite frankly, it's warm, tastes good, smells good. Nobody's coming after them, and they kind of are lazy. Now, before I get further in the life cycle, I got to tell you one other thing, and that is that this is one of many slides that I use when I talk about oak wilt. This was one that my major professor took, and I still use it today. And it's only in the last year or so that I've come to realize that these nidodulid beetles, the ones that look like this, are probably not actually vectors of oak wilt. In fact, reflecting now on the deviousness of my major professor, he may have just plunked them down on there and quick took a picture. Because the nidodulids that are actually seem to be more involved in oak wilt spread are really nondescript. That is a much paler color. They're often smaller. And quite frankly, could be much more easily overlooked. But these are the ones that seem to be actually involved in oak wilt transmission. Now, they get in there. I think they're still lazy. I still think they're set up shop in there and they'd be quite happy to stay. But there's one thing that will cause them to leave and start looking around the neighborhood. And that's the odor of a freshly wounded oak tree. And so if oak trees are wounded at a time when the nidodulid beetles are active and at a time when the fungus is producing spores, then the odor of freshly cut oak wood can cause these nidodulids to leave their comfort and go elsewhere. And in the process, they come out covered with spores, attracted to the sap that's oozing out of that wound, and that's when they transmit the spores. And so after root graft transmission, which is by far and away the most important way this disease spread, the second important way is by way of these nidodulid beetles. And so pruning at the wrong time of the year can be devastating. And I'll mention that a little bit in a minute. I'm sure Neil is going to talk about this as well. But that timing oak tree pruning or even like after a storm or something that might happen at any time of year, being aware that there are certain windows that are highly sensitive, I think is critical. In fact, this particular billboard sign taken in Minnesota some time ago, prevent oak wilt, don't prune in May or June. I think now I've heard people who are becoming increasingly concerned and maybe more conservative will tell you not to prune between Memorial Day and Labor Day. Unless you absolutely have to. And in the case where the wounds do have to be pruned, then contrary to a long litany of preaching about the value or not of wound dressings, this is one case where maybe putting a wound dressing on, not maybe, definitely, putting a wound dressing on to perhaps slow the ooze of that or at least stop the beetles from bringing any spores directly to the cut surface is worthwhile. And I, being a conservative guy, I was just having a conversation, email conversation a couple days ago. I think that that no matter when you prune oaks during the growing season, because of the unpredictable nature of our climate these days, and I think some genuine uncertainty about just when these various nidodulid beetles are active, and when the fungus might be sporulating, on the safe side, I'm saying put the wound dressing on between April and September. I mean, it's such a small addition to a tree management program that I think it's worthwhile. And Neil, if you want to question that's okay. But anyways, that's kind of what I'm thinking. So anyways, this was all the Midwest, see? So here I am out in New York thinking, well, yeah, those guys got a problem, they can deal with it. And then back in 2008, we got a sample from up in near Skinny Atlas, and lo and behold, took it to the lab, did some culturing, and it also turned out to be oak wilt, the first record of the disease in New York State. It occurred in, of all places, a neighborhood called Glen Oaks. And once the initial diagnosis was made, the state DEC folks descended on that. We went up there, all kinds of people went up there. The symptoms, now here's the vascular discoloration, but it's not near as obvious as the pictures I showed you earlier. And even in cross-section, you can see a little discoloration here. But this is probably the best sample that I took a picture of. A lot of it was just not real compelling, not a deal breaker for me. But fortunately, our lab staff continued and did the culturing and found we were able to recover the culture. And by the way, that same fruity odor comes out of those petri dishes like crazy. So it's really quite impressive. Now, I don't know why I repeated this slide, so I'm gonna keep on going. Now, the other thing is those pressure pads. I showed you those nice photogenic ones earlier. They're not always as obvious as they might seem. And these are some that were in that neighborhood on infected, what did I just do here? Oh, okay. Not sure what I did. What do I do to keep going here? Do I do this? Get me back on track here. Yeah, see, I'm a Macintosh guy, so no. Oh, there we go. Okay, anyways, the point being that those formats are not as easy to find as you might see. These, by the way, were taken on trees that had been dead for quite some time. So I'm sure they look better early on, but after they've been around for a while. And also, you're more likely to find this kind of thing, this much less descriptive thing, in piles of firewood collected from areas where the trees had oak wilt, and that's why they were cut for firewood. And that causes me to remind me to tell you that, that we do think that the long distance spread of the disease is by cut firewood. Okay, so anyways, this is this neighborhood. This is a part of it. There was a little bit more here, but the confirmed trees are in red. So there were two here, there was one over here, and then another one here, I think that's all. And then all this purple is other red oaks in the neighborhood, and the